spent his first 5 years living in rural Hilbert and then moved to Appleton in 1960. He attended Fox Valley Lutheran High School, graduating in 1972, and then attended UW Oshkosh. He studied 4 languages and business and graduated with a Bachelor of Arts degree. He applied and was accepted to study international business at UW-Madison and the American Graduate School of International Management, commonly referred to as Thunderbird, in Arizona. He was in the process of filling out the residency papers for Thunderbird at the kitchen table when his father Merlin walked in and said, "So are you buying the Apple and Dairy Queen stores or not? Fisher, get off the, well anyway, Fisher, cut bait." He took over ownership in 1981, and now 35 years later, he's here to tell us the rest of the story. A warm welcome for Steve. And start out with my great-great-grandpa lived in Germany in Arnswald, Prussia, and he and his family came over to Sheboygan County in 1858. Of course, without that, I wouldn't be here. So he located in the town of Herman in Sheboygan County, and he was a farmer. Carl's grandson, Heinrich, was a cheesemaker, and we have documents that he had a cheese factory in Sheboygan County in 1913. In 1925, he moved to Calumet County, rural Hilbert, and bought a cheese factory that at that time didn't have a name. It was owned by Frank Kinnear. So after Henry bought the cheese factory, he named it himself Dairy Queen Cheese Factory. And this is the warranty deed for the purchase of that cheese factory. And the mortgage. So there's a sign on the factory, Dairy Queen Cheese Factory, Henry G. Liebsite. When he bought the factory, it came with equipment for making ice cream, of course making cheese, and bottling milk. That was the milk bottling equipment, the ice cream machine, and no picture of the cheese equipment. In 1938, Illinois, completely separate from this, two men developed both an ice cream mix and a new type of ice cream freezer. It was a continuous freezing freezer with a spigot. That's the difference between a batch freezer and what we have now for the Dairy Queen machines. So in 1938, they got together. They opened this Sherb's ice cream shop and sold all the ice cream you could eat for 10 cents.
Where was that shop?
That was in Joliet, I believe.
And in 2 years after that, the first Dairy Queen drive-in opened, also by Sherb Mobile. Yep, Joliet, Illinois. In 1941, Henry and Lydia, his wife, moved to Appleton, and they started a Dairy Queen restaurant. And not long after, they removed it. Not removed it, they moved it. Just a couple blocks down at what now is the corner of Locust and Wisconsin Avenue. And when they moved to Appleton, my dad Merlin stayed out at the house in the country, and Henry's hired man and his family moved into the house out there. But that didn't last long. Guy's family didn't get along with Dad so good, so they moved out. Dad had the house to himself. That's the Dairy Queen Cheese Factory. Not Cheese Factory, Cheese, Dairy Queen store, restaurant. Well, it says store, it says restaurant. And that's the interior.
Where is that located?
Locust and Wisconsin. I found that on Monday, believe it or not. So, Herman Waldorf was a farmer during the Depression, and he worked farms for people, and often just worked 1 year at each farm, and so the family was kind of getting bounced around. My dad, Merlin, would go to their farm to pick up the milk for the factory. So he got to know Edwin, Herman's son. And Dad wanted to take this girl out, but he was shy. He didn't know how to ask her. So Edwin said, well, I'll ask her for you. So he came back and Dad said, what happened? And he said, well, yeah, got a date. Dad said, super. Edwin said, but I asked her for myself, but you could take my sister out and we'll double date. So they started dating in 1939 and ended up getting married. The guy on the left, that's Edwin, and Merlin and Irma in the middle. And that's Dad wearing his garb that he wore when he was doing his ice cream deliveries. And let's see what this is. This is Henry, Henry. Of course, Merlin, Erna, my brother Larry. So I have in the back there a copy of this 1944 contract between Henry, Lydia, and his son Merlin and Erna to form a company called Dairy Queen Products Company. And at that time, Merlin took over ownership of half of the business of the ice cream, milk bottling, and cheese making. And this is the contract for the partnership. It's funny because, well, Tom would know this, but my brother Larry is a lawyer, and I showed him some of these papers, like the warranty deeds and the mortgages and stuff. He looked at it and said, that's not legal. So Dad ended up getting drafted. Mom's still not very happy about that because he had a business to run and he had a less than 1 year old son and a wife to support. But he was a Lutheran cheesemaker in a predominantly Catholic farmer area. So got drafted, but all the farmers were essential workers. He ended up in Germany. In fact, when he went over on the boat, first landed in Scotland, and then rode trains across England, and then on a ship again to get to France. Well, in Berlin, Adolf Hitler heard that the Leipzig had gotten there, that he had landed in France. And the very day that Dad landed in France, Hitler killed himself. Yeah, so Dad was in Germany. Mom was taking care of all of this stuff that milk bottling and ice cream making. She moved the equipment into Appleton because she didn't want to be out in the country doing that with a little baby all by herself. So they had a garage right behind the Dairy Queen restaurant. They moved the equipment in there, and Dad's younger brothers, John and Hank, would help her out during the school day. First in the morning, they washed bottles, and then at noon, during their lunch break, they picked up milk from the Appleton Pure Milk that had been processed for Mom, and then they finished bottling the milk after school. A man who had worked at the Funt Cheese Factory in Sherwood, Julius Schmidt, got discharged from the service, and he wanted to get back into the dairy business. So he asked Mom if he could have a job, and she saw that as a way to get back out to where she was supposed to be. So they moved the equipment back and used the factory again. So, yeah, when he was in the service, Dad wrote Mom a letter, and he was just complaining because he was so sore. He and a buddy of his had found some German army draft horses, and they found some saddles. They put the saddles on the horses and went for a ride. These horses weren't riding horses, so they couldn't make them do anything that they wanted to. The horses went wherever they wanted to, and finally they got sick of it, and they walked back to the barn, and Dad just rode along. So Mom rode him back. At this time, she had appendicitis and was running a business and raising her son. And he said, "Poor baby." And Merlin didn't write back for 8 weeks. Here, the tank man wanted to be in the cavalry. Well, Mom tried to get Dad out of the service, tried to get him discharged for dependency, and contacted the Red Cross 6 times and never got an answer from them. So Herman, her brother, was in the paratroopers, and he had a 14-day furlough. So he was back at home, and the night before he had to leave back, heading back to his base, Mom decided to make him a nice dinner. Now, she hadn't eaten, she tells me, any solid food from May until September because of this appendicitis, and was just trying to draw it out as long as she could. So she made us a nice dinner, and as the top says, "I'm going to eat some of it if it kills me." And by midnight, she was at St. East in the emergency room getting operated on. That's her on the porch with Larry. No, actually, Larry's in the truck. She's on the porch recovering from her appendectomy. That's John, Dad's brother, who was in high school at the time. Larry on his lap, and Mom recovering. So Henry wrote to General Eisenhower about getting Merlin out of the service so he could help run the business and take care of his family. Merlin had already made a request for discharge himself, and so Major General wrote Henry a letter back and saying, "Hey, Your son put in for a discharge, and he's already got one, so we won't do anything more. And Dad eventually got discharged on Valentine's Day, 1946. There's his discharge. And that's the letter from Major General Witzel to Henry. When Dad got out of the service, he told Mom he was going to do his calisthenics and all of his physical workout every day because it felt so great once he had gotten in shape in the Army. Of course, it didn't last. And this is a letter from Red Owl Store in Hortonville telling Dad how much they liked his ice cream and they would like to get a cabinet set up in their store so that they could sell his ice cream. Probably shouldn't say this. I don't know if anybody's related to these people. But Mom said all they wanted was a freezer to use. So, Roan and Erna went to Atlantic City for a dairy expo, which I find pretty amazing back in those days. And this would have been in 49. And people saw their name badges in World and they said Dairy Queen. And they were saying, wow, you've really got a tremendous business going there. You've got to be doing really well. And they had no idea what their people were talking about. They were talking about the people in Illinois that were setting up the Dairy Queen drive-ins. So Dad contacted his lawyer and made sure that his name, Dairy Queen, covered all dairy products in Wisconsin. In 49, Howard Dale of Dairy Queen of Minnesota approached Dad and Grandma about using the name in some of the counties in Wisconsin, and they said, no, it's ours. But then they started negotiating, and Dad ended up with Appleton and 5 miles all around to put up Dairy Queen stores. Then Henry and his son, John and Merlin, made a new partnership for the Dairy Queen drive-in. And in 1950, they purchased the property at 2000 South Oneida Street and built the new Dairy Queen drive-in building, which amazingly took less time than the one that I built. They got theirs done in less than 2 months. And that's the warranty deed purchasing that lot. Now, the three partners each put in equal amounts to build the Dairy Queen. And some of these things are really funny. Labor for $6 that Henry put in. Kefir Electric for $1.06, John put in. And then Merlin put in all these really big stuff like washing powder for $1, a brush and broom for $1.75. Mm-hmm. So altogether they put $7,500 into the business. And that was opening day, June 4th, 1950. And the 8.5 by 11 black and white pictures back there, those four are all of the opening day. And something that hardly anybody knows about was back in 1950, ice milk was not legal in Wisconsin. The farmers didn't want ice milk because they wanted demand for cream. So they only wanted ice cream to be sold. So the first 2 years, Dad and his partners had to sell a sherbet product, and it wasn't good. People didn't like it. In fact, the last day that store was open, when I tore it down in 93, a guy came up and talked to Mom and Dad, and he said, you know, I was here on the first day you were open, and I got a cone, and it was awful. And this is the first time I'm back. Customers remember. Now, this is their profit and loss for the first year. And they had a whole $1,195.77 to split three ways. So it wasn't looking real great. But if you're selling something that nobody wants to eat, I guess this is their inventory that my crews get a kick out of because of how cheap everything was back then. This is a letter from the JCs to Dad that they had a pancake supper, and he helped out with some kind of product donation. And they're thanking him for helping raise a whole $101.75 for the Appleton Memorial Hospital Association. It's just a scene from the 50s. And that's Erna and Merlin working the store. And that's me driving the truck. This was a sign out on, was on Highway 55. The same year that the Oneida Street Dairy Queen opened, Grandpa died. And according to the partnership agreement, Dad bought out his share. And it's my siblings and I enjoying some Dairy Queen with relatives and neighbors. I'm the cute one. And yeah, if they didn't have ice cream to put in there, I could ride in it. In fact, that truck, it's a little aside, only had a driver's seat in it. And my sister and I always liked to ride along with Dad to go to Nina to pick up mix. He saved on delivery fees by going and picking it up himself. So on the way over there, the back end was full of 10-gallon mix cans. And we sat on a wire crate. No seat belts, no nothing. The crate wasn't even fastened to the floor or anything. And we'd go over to Galloway's to pick up the mix. And we would play on the metal rollers that the cans rolled along. So we'd go in between the cans and the metal rollers, which wouldn't be acceptable today, I don't think. And if it was a big load, Dad would pack the cans all the way up to the dashboard on the passenger side, and we'd sit on the wheel wells between the cans. It's insane, but that's how we did it. Mom said, "Why did you guys do that?" And I said, "Because we were with Dad. It was fun." That's Richmond Street at night. That's one of my favorite old pictures. I'm not really sure. Does anybody that knows old cars?
It's about 52 Chevy. 51, 52.
Yep. Well, actually, this was built in 53.
Okay, then it could be the car next to it might be a 55.
And that was the ice cream machine out in the plant. The contract that Dad had with Dairy Queen of Minnesota was that he could keep on making his hard ice cream until 1960. So for 10 years he could have kept doing it. He ended up just doing it until 1957. And by that point, the Dairy Queen drive-in was doing a lot better. And a lot of his customers were just using his freezers for other stuff, and they weren't stocking up on ice cream. So he just said, "Hey, this is kind of pointless now." But I sent these two pictures to the manufacturer of that freezer a couple of years ago. And he said, when he opened up the email, he said, "Oh my God, kid's gonna get hurt." My parents knew better than that. But that was the best stuff, was emptying out the last of the batch of ice cream and eating it. And in 1957, they had the Centennial Parade. And this float, the stuff on it, the Dairy Queen building and the cones and the shake, was a traveling thing. The place it was at before Appleton was in La Crosse, and I traveled around to different places where they had parades. And it's Mom getting us set up on there so we could ride in the parade and pretend we were drinking shakes. So, in 1957, the Griffith Brothers Circus needed a place to put their elephant for the winter. The circus was based in Appleton, and I recently found out that they actually traveled to 34 states. It was a pretty big thing. I don't know where they otherwise kept the elephant, but she stayed with us for one winter. You can see when you exercise her, train her, she learned to push herself up into the ceiling so she didn't have to balance. So, and Dad had Miss Dairy Queen come out to see the elephant. That's how they fixed the ceiling so she couldn't cheat anymore. And 19 years later, I was on a road trip out west, and I decided to stop at, I believe it was Sparks, Nevada. And there's Bertha. This was the polio summer. You guys remember that?
Yep.
We had to stay home all summer long, couldn't go to the city. So Mom taught us how to play softball. Dad never liked to do stuff like this, you know. It's just interfered with his work. These are two of the employees, and what they used to wear for their uniforms were basically nurses' dresses. And that's Mary Bach and Julie Vanden Wildenberg. Dad sold the cheese factory in 1960 for $7,400. It was a personal thing. He wanted to get out of it and get rid of it because my brother had just gotten killed out there in the road, got hit by a gas truck. This is 1962 when the Dilly Wagons were brand new. The driver there is Mark Umness. He was a teacher at Fox Valley. And the dance crew, they were having a Hawaiian themed sail. And there's my mom with the sunglasses in there in the back. You remember the Dilly Wagon music? Nicer after the remodel. Inside of Richmond Street, which our employees now find kind of confining. we made it work. This was the Schrute property next to the Richmond Street Dairy Queen. It had been a welding shop, and then Howie Voigt was in there for a while. And I bought that, so I could tear it down and build a new store. Well, the police wanted to play with the house before I tore it down. So I let them do that and had fun doing it. They were practicing with debt cord to use it to enter spaces, you know, exploding a cord. But they didn't know how to use it. So at this point, what they did was they taped it on the side of the block building to see what would happen. And they made a little line around, broke all the windows out of the house, and people as far away as Memorial Park were calling the cops. And here what they did was they opened up the storm door, they put dead cord on the wood door, then they closed the storm door and set it off. Well, the storm door disintegrated and pummeled the tree like this. I was behind the tree videoing it. They didn't know what would come out. They thought it would all go in. And Mark, can you help me again?
On the right is Earl Iverson, Ed Iverson. And on the left is Zimmerman.
Yeah, Zimmerman's dad is the gentleman that painted the pictures at the Dairy Queen, at the stores. That's Richmond Street when I was done building it. My sister Betty and I designed that building. Dairy Queen at that time didn't have a building for just soft serve, so we invented one. And everybody in Dairy Queen thought we were nuts. They said, no, by the second year, they're going to have to put food in because they're not going to be able to pay this with just ice cream. But we did. This is a house, Smith House, on Calumet Street. That I tore down also to make more parking at Oneida Street. Then I bought the cage, the bar that was next to Oneida Street. I let the firemen and the police play with that too. The police played with the Smith House. And then it's a house on Cooler Street that I bought and tore down. And just when I was doing this presentation, I thought to myself, wow, I helped out the builders around here by getting rid of four housing units. That's the last night that Oneida Street Dairy Queen was open. And we had fantastic lines. The deal was 1950 menu at 1950 prices. And we just had lines.
Oh. What year was that?
That was 93. And since Dad had taking part in building the building, the guy from Statewide Raising said that if he wanted to, he could take the first wax at it to take it down. And Dad was happy to do that. And that's where the Dairy Queen used to be. So, Christy put this in, the players, first generation Carl, great-great-grandpa to me. Second generation, his son was Carl Friedrich Wilhelm Liebzeit. And then his son was Heinrich George Gottlieb Liebzeit. Then came Merlin, John, and Hank. And my siblings, Larry, who's a lawyer now, he dipped dillies when he was in high school. Beverly also did that. Betty managed for me from 82 to 2003. And Dennis is my brother that passed away, and then myself. And Chrissy thought this was pretty cool because this girl, who I think is Jackie Buss, is making two clones at one time. And I said, "You thought that was good? This is Mom doing two peanut butter parfaits at a time." And that's the end of the show. Comments on how Dairy Queen is doing as a national franchise. Wow.
As your lawyer, I caution you on how to answer.
Well, I'm very unique because I have this old contract that originally goes back to 49 and then had some addition on it in 1950. So some of the things that they're doing now that I don't think are very right, I'm immune from, which doesn't make them happy. Like my sign, the Dairy Queen logo. I mean, I think that's so iconic and both of ours turn around. They want me to get rid of that and go to that DQ swoosh logo. But that doesn't represent what I sell. I just sell Dairy Queen. In fact, the colors on the swooshes are supposed to indicate, the blue is supposed to indicate ice cream because it's cold. And the other one, what color is that? Orange. I'm supposed to tell you that they have food. Did you know that? I don't want that sign at all. They forced the system to put in Orange Julius, what, about 5-6 years ago? And I didn't do that either because it's not the business I'm in. And now they have the bakes. And the bakes are being a big disappointment for the whole system, even though people had to invest several $10,000 to put in the ovens and things. The bruschetta sandwich that they have on TV now, it's running this month. Stores are selling like 4 a day of that. And they're wasting national advertising on it. People don't want it. So, yeah. As far as treats goes, for me, they almost never come up with anything. You know, they'll give us a new blizzard of the month, and it's, you know, they'll give us 4 new blizzards of the month for the year. In China, that's the big market now that they're going into, and they had made a commitment to have 500 stores there in X number of years, and they're getting right to that. But they come to our meetings and they tell us, "Well, in China, we've come up with 38 new flavors for this year, and we've got 5 new mall store designs." Dairy Queen hasn't had a new store design for the United States for 12 years. But these guys, well, I should say, they get to travel a lot. Yes?
The landscaping around both stores. Who came up with the idea, and it is gorgeous?
That was my dad, Merlin. He did it all himself as long as he could, and it was fantastic. And now I've hired a professional landscaper that does it. Unfortunately, she's retiring this spring, so I'm lining up another person to take care of it. It's a lot of work. But we get a lot of compliments on it. Yes, ma'am.
What is your favorite Dairy Queen?
My favorite Dairy Queen, the Fiesta. That's another one of those things that Dairy Queen did for us. Fiesta was done in a Fiesta dish. It was 2 mounds of Dairy Queen with chocolate and strawberry, whipped cream around it, and pecans. It was the most beautiful Dairy Queen product we ever had. Then they told us, "Okay, we're not going to have the Fiesta anymore." And we were upset. And they said, "Well, no, it's not going away. We're just changing the flavors and the name a little bit." And that became the Double Delight with fudge and caramel. So my sister lives in Michigan, my sister Bev. And I got to know a guy that was managing the Dairy Queen in her town. And she went to him and ordered a Fiesta. And she had to tell him how to make it. And he has a regular weekly thing where he has banana split sale on a certain day of the week. She always goes in and orders a Fiesta. Yes?
I was wondering how many Dairy Wagons you had.
The most we had was three.
That's all?
Yeah, and they were... Dad started out with them in 62, and we ran them, I think, until 73. And by then, they were so worn out. I mean, you take them out for a day, and you would have one of them shot for a day. So we eventually just got rid of them. Yes?
Can you just talk briefly about the relationship with you and Galloway
Dairy? Sure. Galloway's, they're like family. We've been buying mix from them since the 50s. It was the Galloway Company that turned into Classic Mix. We used to have three mix suppliers that we could choose to buy from. Galloway's, Badger, and Kohler from Minnesota. When we would have a convention in Minnesota, the Dairy Queen freezer purveyors would each have their machine there to show off. And they would switch off which mix they would use at each exhibition time. And my family could always tell which mix they were using by the flavor of it. The Kohler mix was very sweet. The Badger mix was really flat. And the Galloway mix was the perfect in between. They make really, really super mix. And people, when I brag about it, my mix supplier, they say, what's so special about it? So I had to call Ted Galloway and say, what is it that's special about it? And he said, well, we use only liquid whey. And our liquid whey is all from the same kind of cheese. So it makes a difference. Very slight difference, but it makes a super product. Mom used to get on Galloway's every spring when farmers would put their cattle out to pasture because of the flavor changing. Yes?
Two questions.
Okay.
Is Edie John's wife?
Yes, Tootie, yes. No, that's something Dairy Queen had printed up. I think they want $25 a copy.
Yes. You can go to dqredribbon.com and get it there.
You don't have any other stores?
Something we can think about?
We can get one for you. Yes, sir.
What's the temperature of your ice cream cakes that they're so hard?
The ice cream cakes, they can
how
be as low
are
as
they?
40 below.
Huh?
They can be as low as 40 below.
Oh, okay.
Say a word about your international
women. Yes, Candy, I'm sorry she didn't come tonight. Our cake decorator at Richmond Street entered the Iron Tip competition. That's Dairy Queen's cake decorating competition. And she made it through the first two rounds, and that got her a free trip to San Juan, Puerto Rico for the Dairy Queen Expo. And she had to compete against four other decorators there, decorating three cakes. And she became the number one Dairy Queen cake decorator in the world.
Wow.
Her cakes are fantastic.
That's me for her. It's not good to get free, but that's good to get.